Audiobook, Simply This Moment. 19 Perfect Stillness, 1. 29th of June 2005. Today's talk is on the final factor of the Eightfold Path, which would be accurate to call the culmination of the path, Samasamadhi. There is only one definition given by the Buddha of Samasamadhi, and that is Jhana. The perfect teacher consistently and repeatedly explained the final factor of the path as one or more of the four jhanas. Never, not even once, did the Buddha utter the words kayik samadhi, momentary concentration, upakara samadhi, neighborhood concentration, or vipassana jhanas. These apocryphal terms were coined much later than the time of the Buddha. A disciple of the Buddha, one who faithfully follows his teachings, must of necessity repeat the Buddha's explanation that Samasamadhi means the four jhanas, only the four jhanas, and nothing but the four jhanas. I maintain that the jhanas were rediscovered by Siddhartha Gautama for this age. They are crucial for the attainment of the path. The only people who say that enlightenment is possible without the jhanas are those who have never experienced a jhana. If you have the experience of jhanas, you know their power, importance, and value, which is why the eighth factor of the Eightfold Path is Samasamadhi. It's an important factor of the path. However, because Buddhism has only recently come to Western countries, people are still struggling to understand the importance of the term jhanas. In past times they thought, yeah, it sounds very good, but the names given to it, for example, absorptions, or right concentration, or trances, always missed the point. That is quite obvious when you achieve a state called an Uttarimanasadhamma, a state beyond the normal human experience. It's the first real stage of transcendence. Scholars have a hard time understanding what that means, let alone understanding its importance to the path. Giving it a good descriptive name may help people understand why they have misunderstood its meaning, let alone know the path to attain it as an experience. The way out of samsara. These days I really shy away from calling samadhi right concentration. I've been calling it right letting go for a long time now, and this evening I'm going to give it another name, perfect stillness or right stillness. The reason I say that is because it is the stillness of the mind that not only gives rise to Samasamadhi, the jhanas, but it's also a beautiful description showing the way to get into these stages. It's very important people experience these stages and discover how easy they are. If we give these stages the right name, a name that describes them at least with some of their important features, even if not perfectly, that will make it easier. It becomes quite clear why some people, even some monks, do not attain those stages in their lifetimes, if they are trying to attain concentration. The very word concentration in the Western world means some doing, some force, or work. We are told at school to concentrate as if it is something that you do through an exercise of will. When we understand what samadhi is, what jhana is, then we understand what a stupid idea that is. It goes in completely the opposite direction of what's needed to gain samadhi. The experience of samadhi shows you the way out of samsara. It shows you what enlightenment is. It shows you the doorway to the deathless. So it's very apt to call the jhanas the doorway to the deathless. Yes, we practice all the factors of the Eightfold Path, but it is essential that they culminate in the jhanas. The jhanas are the doorway, and through them you get the insights and wisdom that carry you all the way to cessation. But first of all, you have to attain those stages of stillness, the jhanas themselves. When we investigate these states of stillness, it becomes quite clear that every time we do something, we are disturbing the mind. We're disturbing the process and making it tremble. We're making the mind wobble. We are doing exactly the thing that stops The attainment. That is why when we talk about these stages, the culmination of which is the stillness of the mind, it becomes quite evident and clear that the obstructions to the path and the obstacles to the jhanas arise because we are always getting involved, interfering, controlling, and managing, even by just having destinations or goals. Have you come here to die? At one retreat that I gave recently, I said, try and meditate without having a destination. The people asked me what I meant by that. They said, we can't do that, we'll fall asleep and the mind will just go all over the place. I said, give it a go and see what happens, but be consistent throughout the whole meditation. For the whole 9 days have no destination. If people have no destination, they feel lost. Why do they feel lost? Because at last, they have nothing to do and they can't get into the doing business. They can't get a handle on something to aim for or to do, so it confounds the doer, it confounds the controller, and underneath all of that is the confounding of the sense of self. This is why the meditation seems so hard. In the first year of my life at Wat Pa Phong, Ajahn Chah used to ask, have you come to Wat Pa Phong to die? Obviously he didn't mean physical death, he meant the death of the self. It was one of those constant refrains that you hear in any monastery. You'll also notice that with me, I've got phases and fashions I go through. Little teachings which are repeated over and over again for about 3 or 4 months. And then they change and I get into another fashion. I will go back to that teaching after a few years and repeat these old things. They are all still valid, but I put them into a different perspective. Have you come here to die? That's what it feels like when you start meditating properly. There is something inside you that dies or comes close to death. That's the aspect of the self called the doer, the maker, the active participant in life that always wants to manage, to work things out, so that you can describe it to yourself or tell your friends. Even the will to know, to understand, is part of this doer business. That's why it gives rise to doubt. Each one of the hindrances keeps the mind active and stops it from being still enough to see that the 5 hindrances are all about doing something. Obviously, the first hindrance of sensory desire, craving, wanting something, is all about going to some sort of destination, some place you want to get to. Aversion, the second hindrance, is about not wanting to be here in the first place, and that creates doing. It's being averse to this moment, to the wandering mind, being averse to anything. I don't want to be here, I want to be somewhere else. The third hindrance, sloth and torpor, is the result of doing too much. You've burnt out the mind. You're just too tired, and the mind has no energy because it's all been wasted in doing things. When people start doing, when they start struggling and striving to get out of sloth and torpor, it's just more doing and it stirs up the mind. I'm sure you think you've got to stir the mind up to become alert again. But you don't really stir up the mindfulness, instead, you stir up more craving. Sure, that brightens up the mind and you don't have sloth and torpor, but you have restlessness instead. In a previous talk I said it was a great insight for me to see that I was always oscillating between sloth and torpor and restlessness. I'd be slothful in the morning because Thailand is such a hot country for a Western monk. The food was terrible and there was no nutrition in it. No wonder we had low energy levels. It was a physical problem. At 3 o'clock in the early morning when we had to get up, we hadn't had enough sleep and we didn't get enough nutrition. We were hot and sticky. Not used to that environment at all. Physically, of course, we were tired. So, what did I do? I struggled to get through that tiredness. Come on, Brahm, get your act together. Be more mindful. And because I was controlling and managing and Forcing, yes, I would break through the sloth and torpor, but then I would be restless. Thinking about all sorts of things. I was oscillating between the two. When I got restless, I'd calm down, stop the thoughts, and then I'd just go into dullness again. Some of you may recognize that oscillation between dullness and restlessness. This oscillating between those two hindrances all comes from doing, from trying to control. That's the reason I've had incredible success on meditation retreats when I tell people, if you feel sleepy, go and rest. They say, oh, but I should fight my sloth and torpor. I can't go undressed. That's being lazy. I say, listen, go and rest. And because Malaysians and Singaporeans are quite faithful and have a lot of trust in me, they do that, and they always get good meditations afterwards. They usually only rest in the first few days, and afterwards they have all this energy. At the last retreat I taught in Ipoh, we had some incredible results. One lady, who was already sitting for 4, 5, or 6 hours at a time, sat for 8.5 hours on the last day. It was just so easy. She had so much stillness that she didn't want to move. That was because she had stopped doing things. She had stopped making the mind move. Stillness was her goal, not seeing nimittas or holding on to the breath. Not attaining jhanas or enlightenment. She had a meditation that had no destination. The aim is not getting somewhere, it's being here. Being here and being still. The last of the hindrances is doubt, always wanting to know. That is just another doing. Knowledge is almost like control. Measuring is how we find out where we are in life. And that doing, measuring, and wanting to know, makes the mind move. Be quiet. You'll know later on. Don't interrupt the lecture, just wait and don't do anything. This is the path of samadhi. Mara, I know you. When you don't do anything, you're not feeding the hindrances. This is where mindfulness should be used in your meditation. It doesn't matter what you are experiencing. You may even be thinking of sex. The point is to make sure you don't do anything. Don't get upset. Don't encourage it. Don't get into aversion. In fact, don't get into anything at all. If you put peace into this letting go by putting stillness between you and whatever you are experiencing, things start to slow down and stop. It's the hindrances that are the problem, not what they have created. It's the creating power of these hindrances that causes more suffering and a lack of stillness for you. So, if you put your mind in the right spot and watch the play of the hindrances, the doing, craving, wanting, the trying to get rid of things, the talking to yourself, the trying to understand things, and then getting sleepy and upset about it, you can see where the five hindrances live. You find their playground, their home. Once you see where they are playing around, you can knock them to bits very easily. You can kick their ass. When you do that to those five hindrances, they hurt and they stop. You kick them by telling them, shush, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to watch. Do you remember how the Buddha and the great monks defeated Mara? They didn't get Mara and kick him. They just said, Mara, I know you. They saw where Mara was playing. They saw the area that is just between you and the object you're watching now, the area where the hindrances and the defilements live, and they said, no. They were just still, without doing anything. Look at the metaphor of having a destination. Consider how long in your life you have been trying to get somewhere. We've all had these destinations, these goals. It's only a few weeks now until the rains retreat begins. How many of you are trying to get things out of the way so that you are ready for the retreat, trying to get your projects finished and all of your letters written? How many of you have goals and are thinking, when I've got all of this done, then I can stop? But what happens As soon as the rain's retreat starts? You have another goal, now I am going to get some jhanas. I've got to do this exercise, I've got to write this book, I'm going to read that book. Always setting goals, when you've got goals you've got something to do. Isn't it amazing? If you put yourself into a hut and say, I've got nothing to do, absolutely nothing. All those letters I am supposed to write, who cares? I'll put them in the bin and burn them all. I'm doing absolutely nothing, having no goals, no destinations. I'm not just saying this, I'm doing it. I'm not reading any books and I'm not going to write any letters so that I can do samadhi. You're missing the point again. This sense of self, this delusion, is so sneaky that most of the time we let go of one thing, only to do something else. We are always striving to go somewhere, always active, always doing something, and because of that we are missing the path to samadhi. Sometimes you sit in your hut and that's good enough. Whatever happens next, who cares? You think, I'm just going to be aware of what's happening now and do absolutely nothing about it. Even if your hut is a mess, sit there and do nothing about it. Even if your mind is a mess, do nothing about it. Just do nothing. If you understand what I mean by this, you're making incredible peace. You're making stillness, and after a while when you attain the jhanas you understand what the whole process is about. You also understand why people don't get jhanas, why they don't even get into deep states of meditation, and why they don't even watch the breath. You should know from the Anatalakkhana Sutta that if the five khandhas were me, if they belonged to me, if they were a self, I would be able to tell these five khandhas. Oh, may my body be so, oh, may my vedana just be the pitijaka of deep meditation. Oh, may my perception be of the light of nimittas, oh, may my saskaras be still, oh, may my consciousness of the five senses disappear and may I only have the consciousness of the mind, oh, may I get the jhanas and become enlightened. The Buddha said you can't do that, it's impossible. So can't we understand what the Buddha is saying and stop it? That's actually what the Buddha said, stop it, stop it. Monks, stop it. Lay people and visitors, stop it. Stop doing things, stop going places, and trying to achieve things. If one really stops all this running around, one sees the meaning of Sisara. Sisara is the perpetual wandering, the perpetual moving, the perpetual journey. Always walking on and thinking that when you get to the next step or the next goal, you will be able to rest there and do nothing forevermore. But that journey is endless. You are always going somewhere, walking, traveling, and trying to get somewhere. That's not been just in this life, it's been going on for countless lifetimes, and you've never ever stopped. There is an old English phrase, in the journey of life, please remember to stop and smell the roses. What I mean by that is in your lifetime please stop and smell the jhanas. That is what happens when you stop. You smell the fourfold jhanas, the first, second, third and fourth jhana, because you have stopped trying. Many meditators have told me that because they have taken this advice to stop dash, which goes against the grain, and have actually given up, let go, and abandoned everything, they get into the deep states of meditation. It works. It's true. This is how I meditate. I sit down and I don't do anything. All my mindfulness is directed to making sure I don't forget and start doing things. That's the nature of the delusory self. The thing we are trying to uncover and see is a fallacy. Whenever you think you exist, or assume you exist and perceive that self, that is the cause of doing things. When the me illusion is active, we always interfere with things. That's what the self does. That's a me-its function is to interfere. That is why this sense of non-doing, of stillness, goes against the grain. It goes against the grain of what the self, what the illusion, really wants. Give up hope. The self is that which controls the whole purpose of being. To be is to do. You have got to do something, otherwise you feel that you are dying. In the last retreat, some people who experienced samadhi said they thought they were dying and they were afraid. So I said, well done, die some more. It's fun dying. You die to the body and the body disappears. Die to the five senses and you can't hear or see anything. It's as if you were a dead corpse. You die to the will, to everything. Imagine what we are saying here. When there is no will, the body is not moving. It's not reacting anymore. You poke it and it doesn't respond. If you were in the jhana and someone opened your eyelids and shone a light into your eye, it wouldn't respond. You're dying to the world. That's what Ajahn Chah meant when he asked, have you come here to die? When the doer dies, so does a large part of consciousness. Temporarily. That's what stillness means. That which moves the world has now temporarily gone. Lots of things have disappeared and you've died. If anyone remembers their past lives, that is what it is like to die. It is so similar to the dying process. After the pain and the trouble of the dying process, the five senses disappear. Just as the five senses disappear in deep meditation. With the death experience, you still have a little bit of will left. That's the problem. If you can let that go, you get into the jhana realms. That doing is what keeps you active and stops you from being reborn into the jhana realms or even going to nibbana. There are a lot of similarities. So once one understands what stillness is, what the defilements are, and what the hindrances are, it should become obvious how to get into jhanas. Don't try and sit through pain. That's doing something again. That's just some sort of attainment, some sort of brownie badge, or scout badge that you can put on. There, I've sat through pain. We are not here to get attainments. We are here to let go of everything. Letting go is what some people call attainments, but in truth, in reality, it's a non-attainment. You haven't done anything. You have stopped doing anything. You wonder why people praise you for these things. You haven't done anything. It's true. If you get into a jhana, you haven't done anything. That's what makes it so beautiful and wonderful. You are going in completely the opposite direction to what is supposed to be praised in the world, that is, getting attainments or getting medals. You don't deserve any medals. You don't deserve any praise because you've attained these states due to selflessness. So, if you want to attain those jhanas, do nothing. If you want to do nothing, give up your sense of self. Give up your pride. Give up your ego. Die to yourself and completely abandon everything. Be someone who has no destination. Christianity gets it wrong when it says that on the doors of hell there is a big sign saying give up hope, all who enter here. In meditation, give up hope, and you will have everything you ever wanted, joy, bliss, happiness, and so much stillness. It's in the stillness that you experience the power of samadhi. You may not have got into jhanas yet, but those who have experienced deep meditation states, notice the stillness in them. The more still you are, the less the mind moves, and the more happiness you have, the more peace you have, the more power the mind has. You can feel this is going in the correct direction. Perhaps that was one of the reasons I was able to develop deep samadhi, because even the first time that I meditated, I felt that something there was right. The peace was becoming still and things stopped moving. I felt that I was on the correct path. Fortunately, I had good teachers who even in those early days encouraged me in that way to stillness. So, don't do anything. Just see how much you cannot do. Catch any movement of the mind that might try to do something or get somewhere. You are sitting down, and you are on a journey of life. You are not moving and you are not looking forward to any destination. You are not holding anything from the past. You are practicing a no-destination meditation. This is absolutely good enough, and so I don't want to move. You build stillness upon stillness upon stillness, always seeing the cause of any vibration or trembling in the mind. Anything that stops the mind settling into this deep meditation is all coming from the illusion of self. You want to get jhanas because you think that is going to make you a better monk. That's an ego trip again. You want to get enlightenment. It's ego again. I'm enlightened. I'm a Narayan. I've got the jhana. What have you got? You've only got second jhana. I got that years ago. I've attained third jhana. All that sort of stuff that sometimes comes up is ego. That is the reason we don't start shouting out our attainments in public, because it doesn't make sense. They have nothing to do with an ego or a self. Ego is the complete opposite of these attainments. Who's attaining these things? No one is. It's just a disappearing from samsara, a stillness, a vanishing. The whole eightfold path is a vanishing act. You are disappearing more and more and more. How can you disappear by being still? Haven't you ever noticed that when things are still, they disappear? When your body is still, it soon vanishes from your consciousness. Consciousness is called vinaya in Pali because it discriminates. The prefix vi implies it's two, the same as the Latin word bi. It means two things. An object has to move both backwards and forwards for consciousness to know it. Consciousness needs something to compare with, and anything that is perfectly still eventually stops consciousness. That's why consciousness can only know movement and change. Sisara is anicca, impermanent, but when anicca stops, nibbana or cessation is nukka, which is permanent. When things stop, nothing moves, there is stability. So, the path into this meditation is to sit there and not do anything. Many monks know that when they start to develop jhanas, they tend to force the mind. First of all, they try and sit for long periods of time. They strive and strive to watch their breath. But all monks know that at the very end they have to start letting go and stop doing. In fact, it's even better to stop earlier, from the very beginning, instead of wasting time. That's what experience has taught me. Years ago, I'd meditate and really watch the breath, really force my mind onto the breath, and then when I had a breath, I would let go. I eventually realized that I was wasting too much time. Now I let go straight away when I first sit down, not doing anything, just making peace with the moment. It doesn't matter what I am experiencing, what thought is in my mind, what sound is around me. As Ajahn Chah famously said, it's not the sound that disturbs you, you disturb the sound. It's not the thoughts that disturb you, you disturb the thoughts. It's not the pain that disturbs you, you disturb the pain. It's not the five senses that disturb you, you disturb the five senses. It's not even the hindrances that disturb you, they're old karma. Once you see them, it's you who disturb the hindrances. You make the hindrances grow and give them power. If you say, five hindrances, I know you, you don't disturb them. Just say, I know you. I see you. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not going to move because of you. Then the mind doesn't move and the mind starts to slow down and stop. It's a wonderful process just to sit there and watch. You have all these thoughts because you have responsibilities and perhaps you have been talking too much, so just sit down and stop. First of all, the past and the future disappears because you have stopped in time. That means there are no minutes, hours, days, or years. Is it morning or afternoon? Who cares? Stop the clock with present moment awareness. All those thoughts in the mind, just leave them alone. And in a few minutes they stop. Understand where the thoughts come from. You are prodding the mind, poking it, making it move. And those thoughts are what a moving mind sounds like. It's as if you're wearing one of those plastic anoraks. When you move, it sort of rustles. That's what you do with the mind. There is a sort of rustling in the mind. It's because you are moving it. If you shake a tree, you hear all the leaves and twigs moving. All these thoughts are the result of shaking the mind. If you leave the tree alone, it will be absolutely still. It doesn't make any noise at all. That's what happens with the mind. You just stop, don't do anything, and the thoughts slow down completely. They finish and vanish. If you try to stop the thinking by doing it, just goes on and on forever. It just goes on and on forever. It just goes on and on forever. It just goes on and on forever.